Good day. This is our continuation for the discussions involving construction contracts. And this is now the part four. So utilizing the same source, which I will be using later on. And this is now going to tackle about the second method in computing any gross profit or loss under construction contracts. So just a quick recap, we've said that there are two methods. Either we use input methods, which could be the most common one is cost-to-cost method, which is very easy, if not very, but easy or easier to compute, comparing that with other methods. So let's go back to the source. This is under output methods. Now, clearly from the name itself or term, if we say output method, so what we basically mean is that the basis of the percentage of completion will be whatever has been the work done divided by the total supposedly work to be done. So whatever was completed over the overall items to be completed, including, of course, with that is the item that is already done or completed. So in that case, output method really is based on direct measurements of the value to the customer of the goods or services transferred to date. So this is in relation or relative to the remaining goods or services promised under the contract. This is the reason why output method supposedly is favored in our accounting standards, supposedly. However, there is really a challenge on the part of the cost to be involved in output methods, plus the inclusions of the experts in the field. So who can really determine like what percentage or what was really the work done or how many units really in terms of the total completed unit was really there or were really completed in the process. So just like for equivalent units of production in our cost accounting subjects in process costing. So what really was the equivalent unit? In that case, that is really a matter of professionals or experts in which these are things beyond the control and expertise and knowledge of the accountants. So this is the reason why we also have to consider the fact that because it is costly, as being said here, that the outputs used to measure progress may not be directly observable. So that's why we need to employ experts to do. And if we employ the experts, that would involve cost. Of course, professional fees are at stake. So that's why for the sake of the CPA board examinations, it is a common method and practice that we use cost to cost. So that's why in the first three parts, including the theories, we've discussed cost to cost. However, in practice, many entities use the output method. So incurrence of cost is not necessarily proportionate to the entity's progress on the contract, most especially, for example, for high-rise buildings. So this is like taller than the maximum height of people willing to walk up. So walk upstairs. So that's a high-rise building, and higher than the high-rise is called skyscraper. Anyhow, that's an additional info here. So we are going to employ output method if ever the incurrence of cost is not necessarily the measure really of the progress on the contract. So application of the output methods would really involve considerable degree of expertise and professional judgment. That's why these are, again, not necessarily like employed by a lot of companies. Engineers and architects will be involved, and CPA is not expected to be proficient for using output methods. So if, for example, an entity uses the output methods, the CPA may use the input methods just to assess how reasonable the output methods are. And then the CPA also, in performing external audit, may rely on the judgments, professional judgments, of course, of the experts considering the output method. Now, because there could be some differences as to the amounts that will be obtained in terms of the revenue, cost, and profit if we use various methods. That's why for PFRS 15, we need to apply a single method of measuring progress consistently for each performance obligation satisfied over time. So remember, PFRS 15 requires us to analyze contract per contract basis. So if you use, for example, for this type of contract or these types of contracts, this particular method, so we have to be consistent in applying that. Unless there's really a need for us to revise, which is like very limited or constricted anyway. So just like input method, we are going to make use of percentages. So percentage of completion in that case. The percentage of completion in this illustration is done by a professional. So just a survey, so it is 80%. And that's why that's the value that we are going to make use of in computing the gross profit for the year. So to compute the gross profit or loss, that is total contract price multiplied by the percentage of completion. This is the construction revenue to date and also the CIP, the construction in progress. There are no revenues in the prior year. So that's why the revenue in year one to date is equal to the revenue for the year or for the period ended, less the construction cost for this year, which is also to date and current, because this is the first year, that's how we get gross profit or loss. And then, of course, there's also another method that we can make use of. And then I'm getting it that we are used to this method, but there could be a limitation though for this method. So I will be discussing in a separate session, perhaps like comparing the two methods of computing the gross profit or loss, and then which would be beneficial on certain situations and overall speaking. Okay, what about output method, which is based on physical proportion of the contract work? So as said, we're just going to determine like how many outputs or kilometers done, for example, for this four-lane expressway over the total expected kilometers that we are going to finish for this particular contract. So per contract, actually, there are 41 kilometers that have to be finished. And then that's going to be at 13 billion pesos. This is the expected price or revenue total for this particular contract. So we can notice this is the impact of subcontracting. So the total kilometers actually is 94.5, but then we are just given the contract for the 41 kilometers. So here are the details though. For 20X1 and 20X2, we have the cost incurred each year, the cost to complete, and the number of kilometers completed. If you are going to total the two items, that's going to equate to 41 kilometers overall. So just by dividing these values by total of 41, we would be getting, of course, the percentage of completion to date. So I think that is crystal clear here as to the impact or the impact of this one. So that's 25% and 80% here. So meaning to say, we are not yet done at the end of 20X2. So this is how we compute the profit. So total contract price is now another method. A while ago, remember, total contract price, let me go back to that, multiplied by the percentage of completion, we get the revenue to date, less the cost of construction, we get the gross profit for the year. But then for this particular part here, that is total contract price, less the estimated total contract cost equals the expected or estimated total profit from construction. Should we multiply this by the percentage of completion so we get the profit to date? And then if we are going to deduct the profit recognized in prior years, so this would be the profit for the respective year. So this is also another method which I really prefer or like about. Then we can notice that we did not deduct here anymore in this method the actual cost incurred to date, because that is already included here in estimated total contract costs. Then here in 20X2, we follow the same process, except that because this is cumulative 2.24, it's not that clear, but this is 2.24 billion, less the profit in the prior date, and this is the profit, gross profit, that we are going to get in this year. By the way, the profit that is termed under the long-term construction contracts or simply construction contracts, by the way, are gross profits, not yet the net income or the profit or loss, because we still have to deduct here the operating expenses just to be able to get really the values. All right, so these are the values here as of course shown for the estimated total contract costs totaling 10 billion here. So the first part here, 2.3 billion, this is the actual costs incurred to date. And then this is the first year, so that's why it is equal to the actual cost incurred for the year. And this is the actual cost to complete, or the estimated costs to complete. Then totaling 10 billion pesos. For 20X2, this is for 20X1 actual cost incurred, plus the 5.5 billion actual cost incurred for 20X2. And the total would be the cost incurred to date. Then this is 2.4 billion. This is the estimated cost to complete, so that we will get the total estimated contract costs and to be forwarded there. Now, if we use another method for computing the profit for the year, so this is contract price times the percentage of completion, we get the contract revenue to date. So we can actually check that if they are actually the same. So that's 3.25 billion pesos and 10.4 billion pesos as computed. And then take note that these are to-date balances or cumulative. So that's why you have to deduct the prior year's balances to get the contract revenue to date. And then the to-date anyway of 20X1 is equal to the this year value. It is because that is the first year. For 20X2, that is the contract revenue recognized in prior years equals the contract revenue. Supposedly, this is this year or period. It's not to date. Otherwise, it's just equal to here. So it's contract revenue to date slash for 20X2 and onwards, that would be this period, minus the cost of construction, which is squeezed equals the profit for the year. So that this would be equivalent to this method, which is the method that I preferred because this is powerful. Normally, the method like this one is just the support, and this would be favorable in terms of computing the gross profit or loss with respect to the revenue as presented. So the good thing here is that there is really the profit or loss format. For this one, this would not really show like that unless at this point here, which is revenue less the costs. Okay, so what is the realization? It is actually, of course, okay or fine to use output method, provided that it's going to be favorable on the company, favorable in the sense that it's going to be really going to provide the more benefits for the company than the costs, knowing that the output method would be employing and would be using more costs for the company. Then another thing is that we should realize that for output method, the costs actually would not determine or trigger as to the percentage of completion, unlike with the input method like cost to cost method. So the percentage of completion is a factor of the work done over the total work to be done or to be completed in the construction contract. Another thing is that the profit is computed in the same format though, but the construction costs will be squeezed later on. It is unlike with cost-to-cost method that whether we use this method or this method, the two would be equal. Of course, for this method, output method, still the profit or loss for the year or years would be the same. It's just that the cost of construction here would be squeezed. Unlike with the cost-to-cost method, wherein it's going to be utilizing what is given there in the problem, and we will still be getting the profit as a result. Here you can see that it is squeezed. Then revenue minus cost. So I hope that is clear. Hence this realization. So the cost of construction recognized as expense here, 2.5 billion pesos, for example, for 20X1 is not equal to 2.3 billion pesos that is actually incurred. That's the thing under output method. All right. Next, what about changes in the measure of the progress? So as said, if there are any changes in the construction contract in terms of the costs or the revenue, when there are changes along the way, they have to be accounted for prospectively as a change in accounting estimate. So meaning, it shall affect the current and future periods. So we do not change anymore what has been recorded and reflected from the past. Instead, determine its impact in the present time. And then, anyway, the future time will be affected by such adjustment in the present. All right. So in this particular example, there is a change in accounting estimate. And then we have total contract cost as estimated for the entire contract. And then cost incurred for the year 20X1. Then there is a revision in 20X2 for the total cost, estimated costs. And then total cost incurred, of course, will increase in the next period if cumulative. But then if like this one, it's going to be not yet the cumulative. How did I know? Because of the statement and the problem, the total cost incurred just in 20X2 is this amount. So we need to add the two to get the cumulative value. So here, this is again the method that I like, in which total contract price less the estimated total contract cost would get the expected gross profit. So here we can notice that the contract price is constant or the same. The cost incurred to date, of course, would increase the total of these two. And then the estimated total contract cost would change depending on the case. It would increase or decrease. So these are now the expected gross profits, percentages of completion based on 1 divided by 4 and 2.3 over 4.6. So we have 25% and 50% respectively, and these are the gross profits earned to date. For 20X2, we need to deduct the gross profit in 20X1 so that we will get the values now, gross profits for the year. So 500,000 and 200,000 respectively. So in this particular case, any changes to costs will have to be accounted for prospectively, will have impact in the current year, not the previous years. Then this is another way. So we can notice that here, this is cost-to-cost method. So the cost of construction, 1 million and 1.3. You can notice here, they're the same, right? They are not squeezed, unlike with the output method. All right, so still getting the same gross profit. So very favorable to the income statement format, revenue minus cost. Next, for reasonable measures of progress, we're going to use percentage of completion method if ever there is really, for example, a clear outcome and we have a reasonable basis of knowing it. So this means that the outcome can be reasonably measured. So that's a matter of professional judgment, though, in terms of what is a reasonable measure by the experts. So engineers could be employed, although we've said that we're going to use cost-to-cost method. Well, as CPAs, if we have known the costs already, so we can compute the percentage, right? So that's the time that we come in then. But in terms like, can we really reasonably measure the progress? So if we can, we use percentage of completion. However, if, for example, we cannot, then we use zero profit method. By the way, this provision is still consistent with the previous provisions of IAS 11 or PAS 11, which was still allowed before, but now superseded by PFRS 15. Under zero profit method, so clearly from the term itself, no profit shall be recognized, meaning no gross profit. And then which means that the revenue should be equal to the cost of construction that is recognized as an expense. So this is the implication of the zero profit method. Now, zero profit method, please take that down, is also known as hybrid method, or also known as, for some books, hybrid contract method, or some would be using cost recovery method. However, here's the thing. The cost recovery method that is discussed here, which is zero profit method in construction contracts, is not the same as the cost recovery method under installment sales. Remember, in installment sales, the cost recovery is that, or the method is that, we do not recognize any revenue, which is the gross profit, until we recover all the costs. So in that sense, no revenue, no gross profit to be recognized. For the construction contract, zero profit or cost recovery or hybrid method or hybrid contract, this is the case in which we are going to recognize revenue equal to the cost. So there is now recognition of the revenue. Whereas for cost recovery, so everything should be for the cost, and then later on any excess will be for the gross profit. All right, so that's the difference. Also, allow me to mention, although this is under output method versus completed contract method, let me just mention before we go into here. So the previous topic was about output method. There's an abandoned method which is called the completed contract method, wherein all items of the expenses, income and expenses, shall be recognized only when the entire contract has been completed, which is clearly abandoned, because output method is recognizing any gross profit or loss based on the work done, which is still a measure of progress under IFRS 15, which is the recognition of the gross profit over time or the loss over time. But for completed contract method, no items on the income statement, only when everything is 100% completed. That's the time that we are going to record. So that's why it is an X, and it is not synonymous to our output method. Okay, going back to this one, under zero profit method. So when do we use this one? If we cannot determine the outcome of the construction contract reasonably or reliably. So it should be stated in the problem though, in schools, in the academe, but in real life, that's going to be the challenge though. So we need experts to think about such or this. So 9 million pesos contract price. And then we now have the total contract cost here given, and the outcome cannot be estimated reliably. So clearly we use zero profit method. So whatever is the cost, that would also be the equivalent revenue. So that's why for 20X10, zero here. So contract revenue is equivalent to the respective total contract costs incurred. And then for the next year, 2,700,000, which is the contract revenue, this is a matter of squeezing. Is it stated here? Okay, here. So squeezing 9 million contract price less the revenues recognized from the prior years equals the revenue for that year. So that's how we got this one. And then the total incurred cost for this year equals the gross profit for the year and for the entire contract at 2,200,000. By this illustration, we can then realize that it's just a matter of timing of the recognition of the revenue. We can actually realize, so it's again a matter of timing of recognition of revenue and cost, and especially the gross profit, which is recognized in bulk or as a whole. Then we can also verify this by using this particular formulas to compute. So we got the revenue for 20X3 and less the contract cost incurred equals the gross profit. All right, so that's it for part four, and we are going to continue for our discussions in our part five for this series. Thank you very much for listening, and God bless.